here. Admiral Lunney, when he was 17, joined the Navy, was in high school in New York, just like many of you. For another 43 years, he continued to serve his country in the military. And then after that, and maybe in conjunction with some of that, in community service organizations, and as the past president of the Navy League, helped bring our unit into the organization at a larger level, and that has led to so much financial support that it's allowed us to do the sessions and the trips like we're making this Saturday. So we're very fortunate to have him here. Admiral Lunney is accompanied by his wife, Joan, who didn't want me to introduce her, but she Deputy Superintendent, so higher than any of your principals. So she's here to make sure you all behave. She knows how it's supposed to happen. But since so many of our cadets are female, and since our CO is female, although most of the service in the military at that time was male, now even Sandy could go into the Army. Or the Marine Corps, right? Alright, we're going to turn it over to the Admiral. We're going to close the door.
First, I want to thank you so much, Commander. Chief, for inviting me up here, because I've heard so much about this unit. And of course, my first occasion at meeting Commander Gunning was with the Navy League. And he was so high in expressing everything that was good about this unit and how he was doing so many good things with good people. So I really appreciate that. There came a time, as the Commander mentioned, I enlisted in the Navy. There were probably a number of you out there that are about 17 years old, and it was on December 15, 1944, when I turned 17. My father had been in the Navy in World War I in the submarine service. My older brother, Tom, and you can see the picture here on the right, he had also enlisted at 17. And was on a heavy cruiser in the North Atlantic at that time. He was 2 years older than me. With my father's permission, back in those days, I don't know whether it's still true, Commander, but you could enlist in the Navy, this is during the wartime, at 17 with a parent's written permission. So my father, he gave us, it's still the same, but my father went with me and signed up. My mother was not too happy about it, but my father was very agreeable because I was so anxious to serve in the Navy with my brother. At 17, we enlisted and commenced our service at the Naval Training Center upstate New York. It was on a lake, Lake Seneca. It's no longer up there, called Sampson, New York. We had 10 weeks training, but I must reflect back on some of the reasoning behind my enlisting at that age. Some of you can appreciate the fact that it was patriotic and it was in the tradition of our family, etc. But I must tell you, and I'm sure that some of you would understand and agree with me, by enlisting in the Navy in that last year of high school, you were given credit for all your final exams. These included Regents exams and any subject you were taking. You got full credit. So I must admit that to you, that part of my inspiration in joining the Navy was not having to take any finals in my last year of high school. Incidentally, I don't know whether many of you know much And the school I went to was up there on Town Parkway in, near White Plains Road, Christopher Columbus High School. I graduated from PS 89, which was just a couple of blocks away from Christopher Columbus High School. At the Naval Training Center, we entered upon 10 weeks training up at the lake, traditional small arms and firefighting. They would have a hull of a ship, and they'd set fire to it. We had to get in there with fire extinguishers and put fires out. And we were even trained with possible enemy gas attacks, etc. But I did just remember one particular item, and that was IFF. That was Identification Friend or Foe. At that time, the Navy was very much concerned because of the kamikaze friend or foe. They would, we could not graduate from our training until we could identify with a flash screen of a profile of a plane. We had to identify that plane as to whether it was Japanese or it was American. To Pearl Harbor, we sailed to Pearl Harbor. We offloaded several hundred men at Pearl Harbor. They were bringing out and resupplying as many sailors as possible, preparatory to a landing scheduled for November 1st, 1945, on a home island in Japan called Kyushu. We then sailed, I think maybe the commander can give you an idea, down to the Marshall. We sailed from Pearl Harbor to the Marshall Islands. I think you can show them up there. And then from the at each of these points, at each of these points, we were offloading a number of sailors because we were bringing out thousands upon thousands of sailors to the Pacific for the final landings on the main Japanese islands. I was assigned to an LCI out of Saipan, and that was a landing craft infantry. You can see on there, this is a logbook, the front page of a logbook, but I would have to tell you that the indication on there, I don't have it in hand immediately, but there was an indication here, which may be of some interest to you in your training exercises here, of the number of ships. You can see we were assigned to a division, a squadron, a flotilla, and a fleet, the ninth fleet, the fleet that we were assigned to. We had hundreds of naval ships out there at that time. That gives you an idea of the way we were classified and the way we were set up. We were with that division, that squadron, that flotilla, and that fleet. The ninth fleet was how we operated. That summer, the atomic bombs had been dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But prior to that, you should be aware of the great sacrifices made in capturing the island of Saipan, where we were at that time. The Battle of Saipan took place from 15th of June to the 9th of July, 1944. 71,000 American soldiers and Marines landed on Saipan. Of that, over 3,500 were killed, 10,000 were wounded. 31,000 Japanese military were on the island at that time. There were a lot of civilians on the island. 24,000 of the Japanese were killed, 5,000 of them were suicide. We took 921 prisoners. 22,000 civilians that were living on the island also died, many by suicide. You've got to understand that the Japanese had instilled in these people, not only the military but the civilians, how cruel we were going to be if they were ever captured or were ever able to control that island. And the poor Japanese were ready to commit suicide at the northern end of Saipan, called Marky Point, as we used to round it on some of our trips. You could see the white bones of all the Japanese that had committed suicide by leaping off these cliffs for fear of being captured by the Americans. The bombs had been dropped on Japan. We were then ordered, because the war was slowing down at that time, the surrendered on the 2nd of September, 1945. If you recall, there was a big fleet that went into Tokyo Harbor with the USS Missouri. The surrender ceremony took place on the deck of the Missouri. Now, we aboard this LCI, the Landing Craft Infantry, operating out of Saipan, were then ordered to take part in the surrender and the occupation of many of the bypassed islands still occupied by the Japanese forces. Keep in mind the history of our campaign going west out of the Pacific toward Japan was island hopping. We took the major islands, but many of the side of the bypassed islands were still occupied by the Japanese. We did not attempt to attack them or take prisoners there at all. They were just left bypassed, as you would use that expression. Those islands, for example, as the commander has put up a chart here to show you, Saipan is right down here. And all of these islands, this is the Northern Marianas, were occupied by Japanese, but they were left alone. Keep in mind this was Tinian down here just south of Saipan, and I'm talking about Tinian in a minute. And there's Guam. You all remember Guam, because it's an American territory. We acquired that at the end of the Spanish-American War. But Tinian was one of the other islands captured. When we attacked Saipan, we then went down and took Tinian and then captured Guam. Tinian was very important because you appreciate that at this time, the acquisition and building of the airfields was most important because no matter where we had been able to occupy former Japanese territory, these landing fields were too far away from Japan to bomb Japan. The best we could do was to get carriers off there to do any interdiction of enemy institutions on the islands of Japan. You all remember Guadalcanal and the capture of the Marshall Islands and any number of other islands, but that was all around the perimeter of the Pacific Ocean. We started taking the major islands on the footsteps to Japan. Initially it was Saipan, then Iwo Jima, then Okinawa, and the next one was to be Kyushu. That we were all being out, brought out for the next landing, and that was scheduled for November 1st that year. And that was on Kyushu, one of the main Japanese islands at the southern end of Japan. Island that we first went to take the surrender of the Japanese was Pagan Island, just north here. Incidentally, many of you, I'll just give you one historical note. Many of you speak Spanish. I did take Spanish, but I struggled through it in high school up at Christopher Columbus. I did not have to take the final, as you know. But I give you one incident that I read about. When the Spanish first discovered the Mariana Islands, that would be back in the 1600s, 1700s, because of the natives that came out, not understanding personal property, it was community property. They took what they needed, and whenever they wanted something, they picked it up and used it, and either returned it or left it where it was, etc. But the poor Spanish sailors found that the natives were out there on the ships taking whatever they needed and not necessarily returning them. And thereafter, on all of the charts, the Spanish labeled these islands, not the Marianas, Los Ladrones, the thieves, right?
Yeah.
And it was their concept. The poor natives were described as thieves because they came out and thought they could use whatever the things were that were on the ship or which they brought ashore. We got up to Pagan Island and we could see that the Japanese there had really been suffering not all during the war, but they had originally had a copra plantation there. The Japanese had developed that prior to the war, etc. there were small cadres, a contingent of military on each of these little islands. But in particular, one of the groups on Pagan Island, and I'll give you the name of their leader, was Satoshi Morimoto. He was one of the military leaders of the contingent on Pagan Island. But the background of his story is that he was aboard a transport coming down to reinforce the garrison on Saipan. At the time we were invading it, the Japanese were trying to bring in as many troops as possible. But unfortunately for the Japanese, his ship was sunk trying to approach Saipan. So thousands of men drowned on that ship. He and some of the others, survivors of that ship, were able to make it to Pagan Island. So they had been living there off the ground, is that what you would say, off the land, with not any supplies. No, the Japanese could not get in there, etc. They were living off the land. We worked the surrender of those northern Marianas that you see on the chart. We also went up north to Marcus Island, northeast of Saipan, which was another bypass island. But one of the things that we did as Americans, which you should really appreciate, understanding the culture of Americans, we saw these Japanese surrendering, and they were in great need of food, medical supplies, and other resources. One of the first things that we did under the command of the people at the naval operating base in Saipan was to supply these islands, after we took their surrender, with goods, food, medical supplies. Here you see our ship. Remember the LCI 371, there she is. This is at Saipan. We're loading up several tons of supplies aboard that ship to bring up to feed these poor prisoners up on the islands. So that with medical supplies and food. By the way, just to give you a little background on that ship I was on, the LCI. LCI is one of the smallest ships in the Navy, smallest mission ships in the Navy. We have four officers, 21 crew. She's about 158 feet long, on about a 23-foot beam. That's the width of it. So we had a very small ship, but in the middle of the ship, we could carry probably a rifle company of 120 men and land them with the ramps. I don't know, is the way we operate put all of the soldiers on landings that we're operating with in the well deck here, and we have ramps down on either side of the bow, and go right into the shoreline, put those two ramps down, and the soldiers or Marines would disembark from the ship
in that fashion.
We as sailors always got a big kick out of the poor Marines. They got so seasick. We, of course, had our sea legs by that time, but we used to mock the Marines. They couldn't wait to get off the ship. And we got the biggest kick out of watching them try to maintain the sea legs aboard our ship. You can see it's it was a very small ship, 158 foot long, but rocking and rolling quite a bit. At Pagan Island, after we delivered the food and the medical supplies to the Japanese, it was here that I obtained the name. This is 1950, September, October 1950. I took the train to Nagoya and visited with Satoshi Morimoto and his family. He entertained me with dinner. His wife traditionally came in and served the meal in the Japanese tradition. And I would have to reflect on one occasion during the meal, we heard a lot of giggling and laughing outside the house we were in, a little tiny Japanese home. And with that, Satoshi got up and he went outside, and he found that his three-year-old son was taking all the local children around, because you know traditionally in Japan, you take off your shoes before you enter the house. And the shoes were at the door. And what his three-year-old son was doing with my size 12 shoes he was beating the children around, and they were fitting their feet into my shoes, getting the biggest kick out of it, and laughing, and pulling other children over. This was such embarrassment to Satoshi Morimoto. He was forever apologizing to me, and of course, the typical American, we thought it was very, very funny. But he was able to relate to me and talk to me about how grateful they were for the way we treated the Japanese. We treated them with respect and with dignity. We provided their food and medical supplies. And we treated them as POWs within the Geneva Convention. There came a time later on when my wife Joan and I were visiting Japan that we looked up Satoshi Morimoto, but unfortunately he had passed away. However, we were able to meet with his son, who provided us with a number of photographs of his father during the war. And with those photos, here is a great photo of a member of the Imperial Japanese Army and how proud he was to serve this country, albeit an enemy. And I must tell you how moving it was when I sat down with him 5 years later as two enemies enjoying a meal, reflecting back on a time when both of us probably had pledged to attempt to kill one another. Reflect on a portion of a letter that Satoshi Morimoto sent to me. And it was dated September 30, 1950. Your visit makes me remindful of my life on Pagan Island, where we enjoyed the U.S. humane treatment for the first time in our lives. Thanks to your country's numerous bounties, bestowed towards a defeated nation thereafter, Japan has been rehabilitated to a great extent, which I believe is the symbol of the victory for a truly democratic nation. This is a fine statement by a former enemy and a recognition of what we as Americans were all about in that war, as we try to do most of the times in projecting our military force and our Navy abroad. So I think you'd appreciate that very much, his statement and appreciation. When I was with him, he was forever thankful to me. And no matter what anyone thinks about General MacArthur, he couldn't have been higher about the way General MacArthur, as you know, was sent at the end of the war to rule all of Japan. And he did it with such a degree of fairness and justice that the Japanese grew to admire him very much. Just in closing, because I'm very much aware of our traditions here within this unit, with Commander and with the Chief, about our service in the Navy. I'm also a member of the Sons of the Revolution. My forebears served in the American Revolution here in New York State. General Washington once wrote to Lafayette, "Without a decisive naval force, we can do nothing definitive, and with it, everything honorable and glorious." That was a letter that George Washington wrote to Lafayette on November 15, 1781. And in closing, I quote President Kennedy, who most eloquently stated, "Any person who may be asked what he did to make his life worthwhile, I think he can respond with a good deal of pride and satisfaction. I serve in the United States Navy." Thank you.
got a question?
I'm willing to answer any questions as long as they're not too hard.
You gotta stand up when you say a question so we can hear it.
Sir, I wonder, how do you think about Japanese soldiers right now, a Japanese military? What do you think about it?
Well, my thought process in regard to Japan is to view them as an ally,
yes,
one of our strongest allies in Asia. We've worked closely with them. They have coordinated their forces, especially the Navy, with ours. Indeed, I only read yesterday there were some Japanese destroyers working with our task force off the coast of Korea. They are as much concerned about what's going on with North Korea as we are. So we're looking to the Japanese as friends and allies, and I believe that they are truly that. My sense during the war, my sense during the Korean War was working a lot out of Japanese ports during the fighting and with my ship stationed in Yokohama, Sasebo, and Tokyo. The Japanese couldn't have been more cooperative. Indeed, I'll just give you one other incident. We were involved during the Korean War to get up into North Korea to supply the Chosin Reservoir campaign that's up near Hongnam, and route on the east coast, if you're familiar with that big peninsula called Korea, going up the east coast, the Japanese were helping us with minesweepers, and the Japanese minesweepers during the Korean War, they were not a party in war, that's per se, but they lost two minesweepers, lost all their men trying to sweep the mines off the east coast of Korea to enable us to get up north. So they not only supplied men and equipment, but sacrificed lives. I don't know whether that answers your question.
It does. Thank you so much.
We're really looking for them. Yes, ma'am.
Sometimes we'd
dancing on an island, etc. Maintain 2,500 yards from the ship ahead of you. Watch for this signal light. Watch for this. And also, later on, are you familiar with naval rankings, ratings? Quartermaster?
Yeah.
Yes. You know, quartermaster? In the Army, they know that's the people that give supplies. In the Navy, a quartermaster is the guy that is responsible for navigation aboard the bridge. And of course, I got to know and understand the use of charts and directions and signals. And also, I'm not sure they do that much anymore, but we had to know all the signal flags, because many of the times you'd be signaling ship to ship with signal flags, because you would be in the radio silence in a combat or a semi-combat situation. Of course, with our LCI, we were able to approach a beach, put that bow right in on the top of that beach, but having dropped an anchor maybe 250, 300 feet off the stern, off the back of the ship. Why? Because to get off the beach, we had to haul in, we had mechanical devices, but when that failed, you did it by hand. You had to haul in that anchor, which we hope would be holding there, to get the ship off the beach, and that's underway. So you learned a lot of mechanical things. You learn leadership. You learn how to take orders. You know how to persevere hardship. I was quite excited. I was constantly interested in advancing in the Navy, and I took my written exams, which followed me from ship to ship, and eventually made quartermaster third class, and a commander, and a chief will tell you how proud anyone would be. And we were able to, what would you call the crow? I'm sure you're familiar with that. You call it a crow, it actually was an eagle, and put that on and be a third class petty officer. And even back in those days, we had what they call right arm rates and left arm rates. And right arm rate were the more distinguished ones. Torpedo men and quartermaster, gunners mate, etc. So I think I'm trying to give you a good answer, but does that help you with just naval service? It's something special. The special thing about naval service was teaching you unit cohesion, which I see evidenced here when I came up a couple of years ago during your inspection. Unit cohesion of you all working together with a common objective in mind and pursuing it, preparing for it, and achieving it. Something very distinct that we who served aboard ship are familiar with, as opposed to flying in an airplane or serving on a ground force, a marine, or soldier. The service aboard a ship is self-contained. We're self-sufficient. We face up to weather, combat situations, and otherwise. And every man depends on someone else to do their jobs. And once that man fails, then there's a whole disruption in the conduct of that ship and its mission. So that I think another element that I learned was working with others, no loyalty, but crew under a good captain and leader, as you have here with Commander Gunn. He asked me to say that about me.
Really? Really, Commander? Really?
Both owe me a dollar. Two good leaders. But that's what it's all about. Was there another question?
Would you like to say? Yeah. Paul's were a promise. In your personal opinion, do you think that there will be a war between the type of government and president that we have?
Admiral, that's a political question.
What was it?
And I'm not so sure it's a good idea, but we're going to do it anyway. His question was, with our current political leadership, do you feel as though there is a chance that we're going to have a World War III now?
No, actually, I do not, because our military forces are such the greatest military forces in the world. there's no way that I can see, no matter how much saber rattling goes on in North Korea, that sooner or later China is going to suppress whatever those intentions are, because we just couldn't withstand atomic nuclear war. So there's a lot of noise out there, which I think would be some concern to you. But my own personal view is it's not going to be another World War III. It would be resolved either diplomatically, politically, or otherwise, so that we're going to live, hopefully live in peace. But it never ceases to amaze me. Remember World War I? Was the war to end wars, the 1914-1918 war, the war to end wars. Unfortunately, we're always going to have disputes going on, but I don't think we're going to have another World War III. Was that diplomatically correct?
Very well done, Admiral.
Any more questions?
You can ask them.
Chief has.
Oh, God.
The chief?
One time in war, how difficult was it for you to flip the switch from this is our enemy to now we're helping them? And what was the initial response when we were, you know, trying to bring supplies to the violence, like the Japanese?
So how difficult was it for you to make the switch from Japanese being your enemy and now you have to go help them and provide them with supplies? And how was their reaction to that for you? How did they react? How quickly did they transition?
Well, in the first part, Chief, as a commander knows, we all took orders. Aboard ship, you did what the commanding officer told you. There was sometimes people have interviewed me on other occasions because of other operations we were in. Did you argue? Did you talk to? Was anyone angry? What discussions did you have? Aboard ship, you, whatever the captain says, you do. And you get going and do it immediately. You follow orders. So that I don't think there was a thought process that went on when we were ordered to take up these tons of supplies to this island. Yes, it was to the Japanese, but the war had ended. They had surrendered. They were in great need. They were human beings. And I guess some Christian elements or Judeo-Christian elements came to the fore, helping people who were no longer the enemy. They were very grateful. I don't know whether you recall, one of the scenes that Commander Gunning put up there showed them receiving that. Did you see? There was one small little boy, and amongst the stuff that we brought, you see him? Yeah, he's got candy. Would you leave? And yes. When you talk about supplying people, this island, these islands were made up of civilians as well as military, with children and families. So there was no question in our mind. We were out there to help them. They were human beings, and we did the right thing without question.